Good evening. We thank God for today. Welcome to Tabernacle of Praise, Hour of Power, Bible study each week. Brought to you by Tabernacle of Praise Church International, where Bishop Alfred Jackson is the senior pastor. My name is Elder Warren Hoskins, one of the associate ministers there. We're going to continue in our Bible study this evening. And we're going to pick up at the end of chapter 8 in John, and then we're going to chapter 9. Let's pray. Father God, it's in Jesus' name that we come tonight. Thank you for your loving kindness and for your tender mercies. We ask that you would be with us, Father. We understand that it's only by revelation, Father, that we're able to do what you have us to do. So we ask that you would breathe on us, Father, understanding. Open our understanding that we may see. Open our ears, oh God, the ears of our understanding that we may hear. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. I thought today what I would do, you know, something that we haven't done recently, but I wanted to start. I want to do a song today, a song that we usually sing in Bible study. And those, even though I can't hear you, you can hear me, and you can sing along with me. So I just want to start out with this. Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving. I'll be a willing sanctuary for you. Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving. I'll be a willing sanctuary for you. One more time. Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving. I'll be a willing sanctuary for you. Amen. Thank God for the anointing of the Holy Spirit. Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary. Hallelujah. We praise God for tonight. Thank God for his presence. Just want to pick up where we left off last week. The end of chapter 8. We've been doing an exegetical study. And that's like taking the words and getting the understanding of the various words that John used, getting the understanding of the theme. We're trying to ascertain the theme that John used so we can get the Christological or the Christology picture that John paints for us with the words that he used, the phrases that he used, the terms that he used. He was conveying a message to the reader, and we want to be able to glean from what John left us. So I start at verse 54. They had told Jesus that he was testifying unto himself, and that his testimony was not valid, because in the Mosaic law, it said in the mouth of two or three witnesses, let every word be established. Jesus testified unto himself, supposedly is what they said, but Jesus told them that he wasn't, although he was testifying of himself, he said he had others that testified of him, and he talked about the Father. Now, verse 54, Jesus answered, if I honor myself, my honor is nothing. It is my Father that honoreth me, of whom ye say that he is your God. Yet ye have not known him, but I know him. And if I should say I know him not, I should be a liar like unto you. But I know him and keep his sayings. Your father Abraham rejoiced to see my day. He saw it and was glad. Then said the Jews unto him, thou art not yet 50 years old, and hast thou seen Abraham? Jesus said unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, behold, before Abraham was, I am. Then took they up stones to cast at him, but Jesus hid himself and went out of the temple, going through the midst of them, and so passed by. Now, I point out something right away that you notice here. Remember when Jesus came to the feast, he came unnoticed, right? He came in secrecy, and because of the death threats and you know, the persecution that he was enduring, so he came in secrecy, and which you know, it really shows us something, because I remember when I was a young Christian, you know, you would think that, oh man, that's Jesus. He don't have to, you know, and not I say he was afraid, but he, you know, stones hurt, you know, and he just didn't want to deal with the persecution. So he went up secretly. And so, you know, that keep us from being so heavenly minded, thinking that we don't, you know, that if somebody threw stones at us, that all of a sudden this big shield would pop up, and it may happen, but I doubt it, but Shia would pop up and stop the stone. No, you stones hurt. And so Jesus went up secretly, but now we see him leaving. He passed through them, and they supernaturally, they could not touch him. So it seems like he went out the same way he came in. Secretly, it was supernaturally. So God shielded him. Now, he did shield him. Now, notice he didn't go up initially because of the persecution. But when he was there and he did the will of God, he spoke the word of God. When the persecution arose, when they got ready to stone him, God protected him. All right? God protected him. And so, but he was doing God's will. He done what God wanted him to do. Now, this brings us to chapter 9, right? And remember, we talked about several discourses that we've seen in the book of John. And I was just doing the study here recently, and it talked about the structure of words. And it was talking about the word, and then talked about the sentence, and then the phrase, and then it talked about the paragraph, and then the discourse. And discourse is the largest section, if you will, of a conversation that a person would have. And so we've been talking about the discourses that Jesus spoke concerning certain things that happened. Now we're getting ready to tease, getting ready to talk about something that actually shows that he's going to make a declaration, and and then John is showing us how this declaration is actually acted out. Remember, we talked about the miracles in John's gospel, and I think it was like 7. John didn't use the word miracle, but he used the word that says sign. It's actually a simeon in the Greek, and it's signs that point to something. So in John's gospel, his miracles pointed to something. All of them pointed to something. So he strategically chose the miracles to bring out the theme that he wanted to bring out. Now, it's the man born blind, and Jesus passed by. Now, after he passed up here, where you had at the end of chapter 8, it say, and so he passed by. Then in chapter 9, and as Jesus passed by, now don't tell us where he was passing by. It could have been in the same city. And it more than likely it was. It say he saw a man which was blind from birth. All right. It's not like the man lost his sight, during his life. He was born blind. It's saying disciples asked him, saying, "Master, who did sin, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" Jesus answered, "Neither has this man sinned nor his parents, but that the works of God should be made manifest in him. I must work the works of him that sent me while it is day. The night cometh when no man can work. And as long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world." I want to stop right there. We want to reiterate or expound on those particular passages. Now, what is John, what message can we glean from this particular story that John is conveying to us? And we'll read the rest of it in a little bit. But John was trying to point something out. Now, notice Jesus is coming from declaring, "I am the light of the world." He's coming from the discourse where he was saying, "I am the bread of life," And so it's several of those "I am" statements that John points out and that Jesus makes in John's gospel. So now John is getting ready to quote Jesus as with another "I am" statement. Okay. It says, "We note that the man expresses the human condition prior to meeting Jesus." Now, this man was born blind, okay? Now, we can glean from that, or we can interpret from that maybe John is trying to convey to us through this man the condition of humanity before we meet Christ. Blind from birth, okay? Born blind. Part of the implication of being born into a fallen world is that we have no natural spiritual perception, okay? In the tabernacle layout, there are three dimensions that we often talk about. And we talk about the outer court, the inner court, and the most holy place. In the outer court, we have the natural light, and it's light where all men see. Everybody can see, in that particular environment, everybody can see, because you have the sunlight, right? So it's natural light. And so before we come to Christ, we are blind spiritually, but we have natural light. We interpret things from a natural viewpoint. We have no spiritual perception whatsoever. Now, some people, begin to dabble into the occult and some things like that, and they call it spiritual, and it is spiritual in a sense, but it's not the good spiritual. Okay, but we have no spiritual insight, and mind you, when people do indulge in that stuff and they dabble in that stuff, it is still spiritual darkness. It's blindness. Now listen to this. It's a we don't have any spiritual perception. The thinking become our thinking is a futile, and our as Paul said in the book of Romans, he talked about the state of man or those who rejected God. He said their understanding, their thinking was futile, and their foolish heart was worth darkened. Now, we are born with dark hearts, right? We know that. We've often heard Bishop talk about, you don't have to teach a baby to lie. because the Bible talks about David said, "Behold, I was born in sin." I mean, I was born in iniquity and in sin that my mother conceived me. And so, you don't have to teach a baby to lie. They come out the womb blind. Or I ain't gonna come out the womb blind, but I'm saying that they come out in a fallen state, okay? And so it is so easy for a baby to learn how to get their way by not telling the truth. The blind man represents the fallen humanity languishing in darkness of ignorance and sin without a hope, without the hope of salvation. In other words, Christ is our only hope to our fallen state. You think about when you were not saved, what hope did you have? What hope did any of us have? when we were, because many times when you're out there, I said many times, all the time when you're out there, you don't know that you're lost. You don't know that you're blind. And so if you don't know, it's normal to you. It's only when you are encountered with light that you can see that there's more to life than, and I don't mean this by, you know, no pun meant here, but it's more to life than meets the eye, you know. It said, the man, however, also eloquently models the way of salvation, the turning from darkness to light, to the light of the world. We note that the growth in the healed man's perception from the man they call Jesus, this is what he first referred to Jesus as, the man they call Jesus, then he moves on to, he is a prophet, okay? Then he moves on to, he opened my eyes. He go from there to, he is from God. And finally he says, Lord, I believe and worship him. Now, look at this progression. He went from a man called Jesus. He moves to he is a prophet, right? He opened my eyes. He is from God. And finally, Lord, I believe, and he worshiped him. I'm giving you a chance. Now, the man they called Jesus, verse 11. He is a prophet, verse 17. He opened my eyes, verse 30. And finally, Lord, I believe, verse 33. In verse 38, he worshiped. This is indicative of the first of our faith journey toward Jesus. And it points to our coming to the commitment of serving Christ, the commitment that it takes to be a disciple. Remember, we talked about, and I don't think I've mentioned it in this Bible study, but in the classes of the church, we talked about how that when the Lord at the Last Supper, I think it was John's gospel that pointed this out. When the Lord at the Last Supper, he was troubled in spirit, and he said, "Behold, one of you is going to betray me." And, the disciples said, "Lord, is it I?" The other one said, "Lord, is it I?" And when it got to Judas, he said, "Rabbi," or teacher, "is it I?" So Jesus never moved beyond just the teacher and never becomes Lord, then we never enter into the place of commitment to where he opened our eyes. We can come to Jesus, right, and never get our eyes open. Look at the rich young ruler. Now, some believe that the rich young ruler did get saved. Now, that's, you know, some theologians believe that he did get saved, and certain people, that a person that they point to, we won't get into that. But many people that came to Jesus, they came and they were blind. Look at the people who left him, because he said, "Except you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you." Then what they did was they say, "This is a hard saying," and they left. So they remained in darkness. But it's only those who come to Christ and humble themselves that their eyes are open. Remember? The Pharisees asked him, "Lord, are we blind?" And he said, "You know, if you had not said, or if you were not saying that we see, you wouldn't be blind. But the fact that you say I see, you know, and you seeing away or apart from God, apart from God's revelation, because the Bible says in the book of Isaiah, this is part of the new covenant, they shall all be taught of God, remember? It says, therefore, whosoever should be taught of God, right? You know, and so the thing is that in Matthew 11, 28, I think it is, around about that, when Jesus said, "Father, I thank you that you've hid these things from the wise and prudent, and reveal them unto babes." for such, Lord, is your will. So God hid the truths of the kingdom from the wise and the prudent, those who felt like they didn't need God, those who did not receive the truth, those who did not believe the gospel. God hid the things from them. And I say that to say this, is that even we as Christians come to Christ, and if we don't humble ourselves, there are many things that we may never see. It takes revelation for us to be able to see. Remember, Jesus said to Peter in Matthew 16, he said, flesh and blood has not revealed this unto you, but my Father which is in heaven. So it takes humbling ourselves in order for God to be able to give us revelation. It said, the man also illustrates the repercussions of coming to believe in Jesus. They may be highly upsetting both for ourselves and our families when we come to know Jesus. He will disrupt our lives, okay? In a good way. Eventually, we realize it's a good way. And a lot of times, our families will get upset with it, right? Because we come to Christ. But say the difference in our perspective and outlook may be a rebuke to those around us, bringing to the surface attitudes which we would prefer have been left hidden. And you know that is true. Once you get saved, a lot of things come out. Christ can cause division. And we have this, see this in Matthew, the 10th chapter, verse 34 through 36. And we need to be ready for that division. We need to be ready. When we give our lives to Christ, we come to Christ, we have to be ready. Now, even as we have come to Christ initially for salvation, when we keep coming to Christ, right? We come to him for whatever purpose, whatever need we have, and it may not even necessarily be a need. It may be we come to Christ because, like David said, when thou sayest, seek ye my face, my heart says unto thee, thy face, Lord, what I seek. The Lord may just be calling, you know, and you feel a desire to spend time with God. Not necessarily that you're looking for anything. You just feel a desire to spend time with God. And so when you spend that time with God and God gives you a revelation, you know, give you a dream, actually, you know, and a lot of times when you go and you tell this to people, a lot of times it's going to bring persecution. And we have examples of that in scripture. And it say that, this man's witness was very unsophisticated. He was not part of the rabbinical schools. He wasn't, you know, when they asked him about his testimony, the man said, the man they called Jesus, right? And then, when he met Jesus, you know, we talked about that. It says the story expresses the division which the coming to Jesus produces. I say to those who respond by coming to the light, casting themselves upon the mercy of Christ, his light shines savingly and renewedly. Savingly and renewedly. But those who are judged, are judged who refuse to come to the light, stubbornly clinging to the light that they claim they already have. They go on in darkness, which no light will ever shine. And so they go on in the darkness because they are accustomed to it. Some just don't think it can get any better. They think this is all it is. Okay, now let's talk about the Feast of the Tabernacles. Let's give a little background on that. Remember we talked about after Jesus left the feast, right? And he talked about him being the if any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink, right? And then he said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. Jesus poured out the water, and then he said, I am the light of the world, you know. Now he comes to the sheep metaphor in chapter 10. He comes to the sheep metaphor. Now we have, like I said, in chapter 9, We have Jesus heal the blind man, and we see the progression of salvation. You know, this man was healed, and the man came to salvation and said, "Lord, I believe." You know, and so he became a follower of Christ. Undoubtedly. But in the 10th chapter, Jesus started talking about being the shepherd. So the first half of chapter 10 continues in the settings of the Feast of the Tabernacle and concludes in great central teaching section of the gospel. There are two subdivisions. The first, Jesus illustrates the distinctiveness of his ministry in verse 1 through 18. And in the second, reactions to the teachings are identified in verse 19 through 21. So first, like I said, in verse 1 through 18, he talked about the distinctiveness of his ministry. And then from verse 19 to 21, we have a reaction to that declaration. Now, it links to immediately preceding sections are clear. The links to to the immediate preceding sections, it's clear. There is no break in the flow of the discourse in verse 1. Now, this writer says that we can notice that there should be no break, even though we have the chapter divisions. There should be no break. We should read it because it is a continuation. It's in the reaction of verse 21 is specifically related to the healing of the blind man. There is also continuity in the content of the sermon. The Pharisees' treatment of the formerly blind man in verse 34 is not simply an expression of their personal blindness. It also represents the grievous dereliction of duty on their part. Okay, so in other words, the Pharisees, they call this man in, right? And they question this man, okay? They question him. And when they question him, they wanted to know how did he come to see. They couldn't believe that this man was born blind. Now, all this is going together because Jesus is going to start talking about him being the chief shepherd, the good shepherd. But he's talking about that they called this man in and they wanted to know whether he was born blind. And so when this man gave his testimony, they didn't believe this man. They weren't going to take his word for it. And now they have seen this man. They have seen him out. And more than likely, he was a beggar, right? And so they have seen this man, but they just couldn't believe it. Their eyes couldn't believe. So they called his parents in, you know, trying to trap his parents. And they asked his parents, "Is this your son?" "Yes." "Was he born blind?" "Yes." "How is it that he come to see?" Now, the parents were, you know, they were a little wise because they said he is of age. Ask him. We know he's our son. We know he was born blind, but how he come to see, we don't know. Now, more than likely, the parents didn't know that it was Jesus. Jesus had caused an uproar in Jerusalem, right? And so more than likely, the parents knew that it was Jesus, but it had been said, if anyone, express faith in Jesus, they would be expelled from the synagogue. So the parents said, "Ask him." Now, this is what the man said. The man told them, you know, when they questioned him, and I want to read this a little bit. I want to show you something that this man done. This man, he actually took them to school, right? Now, they ask a man, they say unto the blind man again, "What sayest thou of him?" And he said, okay, let me back up a little bit. It said, then again, in verse 15, it said, then again, the Pharisees also asked him how he had received his sight. He said unto them, "He put clay upon my eyes, and I washed and do see." Now, Jesus, he took, you know, dirt, and he mixed it with spittle, and he anointed the man's eyes, right? And the man said, "He put clay on my eyes, and I washed it." Jesus told the man to go to the pool of Siloam, which John say is translated as sent. So Jesus was showing the disciples something, when he sent the man, he was showing that he is the one that was sent to give sight unto the blind. And the world was in darkness. And you read that in John's epistles more than one time. He talked about the world being in darkness. And he said, the Pharisees asked him, well, how, in verse 15, how he had received his sight. He said unto them, he put clay upon my eyes, and I wash and do see. Therefore said some of the Pharisees, this man is not of God, talking about Jesus, because he keepeth not the Sabbath. Others said, how can a man that is a sinner do such miracles? And there was a division among them. Now notice, earlier John pointed out that there was a division among the people, right? I think this is in verse in chapter 8. There was division among the people. Now Jesus is bringing division among the Pharisees. Okay, and I imagine Nicodemus was, you know, saying, you know, how can this man be a sinner? And Joseph of Arimathea, he was probably on that side too. And there's probably some more that was on there saying, how can this man do these kind of miracles and be a sinner, right? And so, say, with a division among them, they say unto the blind man again, what saith thou him that he has opened thine eyes? And he said he is a prophet. But the Jews did not believe concerning him that he had been born blind and received his sight until they called his parents, the parents of him, and they asked parents of him and had, the parents of him that had received his sight. And they asked them, saying, is this your son who you say was born blind? How then does he now see? His parents answered, as we said, you know, they said, we know this is our son, and we know he was born blind, but by the means what means he now see, we know not. Or who has opened his eyes, we know not. He is of age, ask him. He can speak for himself. These words spake the parents because they feared the Jews. For the Jews had agreed already that if any man did confess that he was Christ, he should be put out of the synagogue. Then said the parents, he is of age, ask him. Then they called the man that was blind and said unto him, give God praise. We know that this man is a sinner. He answered and said, whether he is a sinner, now he taking them to school. Listen to this. We know this man is a sinner. Now, their presumptions were in error. What they based their facts on was an error. Now they said, we know that means emphatically, undoubtedly, we know this man is a sinner. Think about this. This is God Almighty in human flesh doing miraculous miracles that nobody had ever done before. And they said that we know this man is a sinner. The reason I wanted to point that out, because I think about the human mind a lot. Think about how easy it is for people to get into error when they have preconceived ideas about the way a thing ought to behave and the way a person ought to be. And when that person is not like that, then they just assume, based off of erroneous preconditions or erroneous perception, that this must be the case. And they say, we know that this man is a sinner. He answered, then he said again unto them, he answered, I have told you already, and you did not hear. Wherefore would you hear again? Let me move back up here. Let's go to verse 24. Said, then again they call a man and they said he's a sinner. Then answered and said, whether he is a sinner or no, I know not. One thing I know, that whereas I was blind, now I see. Now, he could not articulate the law like them. He didn't have that kind of training, but he had his testimony. He said, whether he is a sinner, I know not. All I know is whereas I was blind, now I see. Now, so that tells me something. That should tell us something, is that when God gives you a revelation, right, God does something in our lives. When God he's done something in our lives, that is to give us an assurance that God is who he said he is. The man say, whether he is a sinner, I don't know. All I know is he healed me. All I know is he healed me. Now this man would take this miracle and we'll see that based upon this miracle, based upon what Jesus has done that no one else has ever done, no prophet had ever done this, this man based the fact that this must be, he must be who he said he is. And then I'm going to drop down here. It says, then they reviled him in verse 28 and said, thou art his disciples, but we are Moses' disciples. We know that God spake unto Moses. As for this fellow, we know not from whence he is. The man answered and said unto them, why herein is a marvelous thing that ye know not from whence he is, and yet he has opened my eyes. Now we know that God, now that's what I say, this he took them to school. In verse 31, now we know that God heareth not sinners, but if any man be a worshiper of God and doeth his will, him he heareth. He took them to school, all their training. He took them to school. He said, now we know that God don't heal sinners. Now, this is what y'all have taught us in the synagogues. Y'all taught us that God don't heal sinners. But if a man be a worshiper of God, him God heareth. And look at this. He's healed my eyes. Okay? Eyes that were blind from birth. So it was, in other words, his eyes was never developed. This was a supernatural miracle. I don't know if they call this a healing, but some healings also bring in it a miracle, because this was a miracle. Jesus had to, I don't know what he done to his eyes, but whatever wasn't there, Jesus brought it into there, and the man was able to see. All right, now he says, since the beginning of the world, it is not heard that a man open the eyes of one who was born blind. Listen to this again. Since the world began, it is not heard that any man opened the eyes of one that is born blind. This man teaching them. Now, they've been teaching in the synagogue, telling them all of this, and this man is now bringing back to them what they taught him. He say, if a man were not of God, he could do nothing. He said, they answered and said unto him, thou art altogether born in sin. You see, now it is, they're attacking the man. They call this ad hominem attack, where when you don't have an argument anymore, you result to attacking the person, And so they had an argument. This man was he said that since the beginning of the world, it has not been known that there has been a man who opened the eyes of one that was born blind. And then he said that if this man were not of God, he could do nothing. At that point, the argument, they didn't have an argument to come back. So they told the man, thou art altogether born in sin. Okay, because he was born blind. They had a teaching, a school of thought that if a child was born with some kind of defect, that the child sinned in the womb. Okay, it was a teaching like that in Jerusalem. I mean, not Jerusalem, in Israel, right? And probably more than just Israel, probably other countries had it as well, but they had adopted it. And they say, and dost thou teach us? And they cast him out. When people lose their foundation to argue, and I'm not talking about arguing back and forth, you know, calling names and stuff. I'm talking about exchanging ideas. When they lose their foundation, okay, to be able to produce a legitimate argument, this is what they result to. They result to calling names. Then they will cast you out. They don't want to deal with you anymore. I thought that was pretty funny, you know, because this is what usually happens, you know, when somebody don't have anything to come back with, they will cast you out, okay? They don't want to deal with you anymore. It's like Jesus heard that they had cast him out, and when he had found him, he said, "Dost thou believe in the Son of God?" He answered and said, "Who is he, Lord, that I might believe on him?" And Jesus said unto him, Thou hast both seen him, and it is he that talketh with thee. And he said, Lord, I believe. And he worshiped him. Let's point something out right here. This is not the only passage we have where it says someone worshiped Jesus. We have it with the healing of the 10 lepers, and one came back and worshiped. If Jesus was not God, and see, this is why, you know, like I said, we could do this study here, this particular study, because you point out some things. If he was not God, would he have allowed this man to worship him? Remember, the angels would tell him to get up. You know, I'm just the messenger sent from God. Peter and some of those, when people would try to fall down and worship, get up. Pardon them when they, I forget where him and Barnabas was, and the people wanted to do sacrifices unto them because they thought they was gods. They hair up and stop them. Don't do it, because we're only men. But if Jesus was just a man, he would not have allowed him to worship him. Okay, so this is something that John is pointing out. You know, and if we're not careful, we'll overlook that. And this is what Jesus said. Listen to this. For judgment I am coming to the world, that they which see not might see, and they which see might be made blind. Think about that. And some of the Pharisees which were with him heard these words and said unto him, Are we blind also? And Jesus said unto them, If ye were blind, you would have no sin. But now you say, We see, therefore your sins remain. So in other words, if you were blind, you will come to me for sight, because I have come to heal. Remember, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captive, and recovering of sight to the blind. Right? So he was saying, if you were blind, you would have no sin. But now you say, I see, and therefore your sin remains. So in other words, if you don't realize that you're blind, you'll never come to Jesus, who is the only remedy for what plagued mankind. And it's spiritual ignorance. We don't know the essence of life. We think a lot of times, remember when Jesus told the man that came to Jesus, and him and his brother was disputing over their inheritance or something to that effect, and the man came to Jesus and said, Master or Lord, would you speak to my brother that he may divide the, you know, and I'm just paraphrasing it, divide the inheritance with me. And Jesus told them, he said, take heed, and beware of covetousness, for a man's life consisted not in the abundance of things which he possesses. So the thing is that that shows us that man can get off thinking life is all about things and what you can get in this life. Never stop to think that when you die, you cannot take it with you. Well, I'll leave it to my kids and when they die. My point is, living to get gain and a bunch of things cannot be the essence of life, because when you die, you leave it. Jesus is the answer. Come to me, Jesus said. Now, we come to verse 10 now. Now, notice what's said, that there is no division. Now, notice in the beginning, or not in the beginning, before the Masoretic, I think that's what you call them, put in the divisions, the chapter divisions in scripture, there wouldn't have been no separation here. And so we should not read it, you know, like, you know, this was a part or should not be along with what's happening in verse 9. So we come to verse 9, at the end of verse 9, he say, we see. So the people say, we see. He say, therefore, your sin remaineth. Listen, then he go into verily, verily, truly, truly, or most emphatically, I say unto you, he that entereth not very verily I say unto you, he that entereth not by the door into the sheepfold, but climb up another way, the same is a thief and a robber. Now, why did Jesus go there? It was the scribes and Pharisees who were supposed to be the shepherds of Israel. They were supposed to be protecting the sheep. And we see this in the book of Ezekiel. In the book of Ezekiel, God's indictment against the nation of Israel, Ezekiel 34, verse 1 through 31. God's indictment against Israel was the shepherds were blind and they were not protecting the sheep. Now listen, okay, and we really see this in the book of Ezekiel. God called them blind. Blind leaders. And they allow God's sheep to be plundered and allow them to be captured and ravished. And so God had an indictment against the shepherds. And so the scribes and Pharisees should have been the shepherds of Israel, protecting Israel. But they were blind leaders. I think one time Jesus says something to them, and the disciples come to him and say, Master, do you not know that the Pharisees were offended by what you said? And Jesus said, let them alone, for they be blind leaders of the blind. And if the blind lead the blind, they shall both fall into the ditch. Now, so Jesus was, we can really see the context of what Jesus was saying out of the book of Ezekiel, the 34th chapter. You get a chance, read it. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that entereth not by the door into the sheepfold, but climb up some other way, the same is a thief and a robber. So Jesus talked about, and the people would have understood what he was saying. At night, the shepherds, when they would retire for the night, they would bring their foals together. And they would create a protection around them. And the only way that you could get in was through the door, which that's where the shepherds slept, right? And the only way you can get in, a thief would not be allowed to come in. You know, a wolf or whatever would not be allowed to come in because the shepherds will stop them. But if they climbed up any other way, he said it was a thief and a robber. Right? It said, but he that entereth in by the door, the same is the shepherd of the sheep. Now, in the mornings when they would get up, and it's been reported that some have seen how it worked, they say, when in the morning when they would get up, each shepherd would call his sheep by name. They would give the sheep pet names, and they would call them by name, and because the shepherd knew that, or the sheep knew that shepherd's voice, they would come out unto that shepherd. No other shepherd would they follow, because they were accustomed to the voice of their shepherd. Now, you know, if he called the sheep Teddy, you think the sheep understood what Teddy was? No, he just knew the sound of the shepherd's voice, and he knew when he's talking to him that that's what he means, Teddy, you know. Teddy, come here. And so the sheep would respond, and he understood he would respond to the shepherd's voice. And this is what Jesus is trying to convey. He said, but to him the porter openeth, and the sheep hear his voice, and he calleth his own sheep by name. He don't call another shepherd sheep, because the sheep not going to respond to him. They going to only respond to the voice that they are accustomed to. Right? And so in this particular chapter, the Lord told his indictment. He said, and I'm going to give you shepherds. You know? And God is saying, I'm going to appoint shepherds, because the leaders were not adequately protecting Israel. Okay? They were spiritually, they were not adequately protecting them. So God said, I'm going to set up shepherds. And then he talked about that one shepherd, talking about the Lord Jesus Christ. It say, and a stranger they will not follow, but will flee from him, for they know not the voice of strangers. This parable spake Jesus unto them, but they understood not the things that he spake unto them. Now, they're looking at the natural. They're not looking at what Jesus is saying by using this analogy. He's using this analogy. Now, you think, like I said, you come from chapter 9, the end of chapter 9 to chapter 10, you see there is no break there. Jesus had talked about them being blind. He talked about, they say, are we blind? Right? And Jesus said, you know, if you were blind, you would come to me. You know, and he didn't say it exactly like this, but I'm paraphrasing it. You will come to me and you will have your sight. But now, because you say we see, your sin remaineth, right? And then he goes, verily, verily, I say unto you. So he's talking to these blind leaders. He's talking to these blind leaders who's supposed to be protecting sheep, but because they are so accustomed to live in a lavish lifestyle, they're so accustomed to fleecing the sheep, and they think gain is godliness. Remember this scripture when I was a young man. I remember hearing it preached, and that thing stuck with me. Perverse disputants of men of corrupt minds and destitute of the truth, supposing that gain is godliness, from such turn away. That was what Paul told Timothy to do. That was probably the first scripture I remember and I was able to quote. But they had fallen in love with the titles and the way people would revere them in public, and how they took the high seats, you know, in public gatherings. And they fell in love with that kind of stuff, but they didn't have the heart of a shepherd. And Jesus had an indictment against them, and he was just repeating what God has said in Ezekiel 34. I have an indictment with you. Okay? And it said, Jesus spread this parable. Then Jesus said again unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, I am the door of the sheep. All that ever came before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not hear them. So I heard someone say that Napoleon, I think it was, who talked about how him and other conquerors had conquered the world. But he said he was amazed by the ministry of Jesus. Said because Jesus had no army, saved by men to this very day, revere him, and men to this very day follow him. Say he was amazed by Jesus. I think it was one of those conquerors, I think it was a Napoleon, that said that, because Jesus didn't have no weapons and none of that stuff. We see it was through the way of humility. It was the way of humbling himself, sacrificing himself, that he was able to redeem us And he gave us an example that we may follow. And it's through humbling ourselves, it's through humility that we will fulfill the call of God on our lives. But without humility, God resisted the proud, but give grace to the humble. If we don't humble ourselves, our sight would never be what it should be. Our spiritual perception, our spiritual understanding, the darkness will continue to prevail in our lives because the Bible says that the bright light in Proverbs, I think 1:4, the path of the righteous is as a bright light that shineth more and more until the perfect day. I think I'm quoting it correctly. But say that it's more, it shines more and more. And it's like when the sun comes out in the morning and that sun goes higher and higher into the perfect day. It's talking about in the top of the day when it's in the top of the sky. That's what that's what the life of a Christian should be like. We should continually begin to see. We should see more this year than we saw last year. We should be more spiritually astute this year than we were 5 years ago. We should understand spiritual truths. We should have a more of a control. I ain't gonna say control. We should be more exercised, for lack of a better word, in the Word of God. We should remember what Paul said in the time that you ought to be teachers. You have need that won't teach you again. Then you talk about how that spiritual meat belongs to those who are a full age, you know, who have exercised themselves in the Word of God. I'm paraphrasing it. But the thing is that if we do not humble ourselves, we will never be able to be the people God wants us to be. And I want to start right there. We'll pick up at verse 8 next week. But we see that it's through humility. And saints, this is not easy. We see right now, instead our country is in today, we see that humility do not come naturally. It's something that we have to work at. It's something we have to put effort into. We have to humble ourselves. I remember when I got saved, I used to hear people, I heard a song, "If I'm too high, please bring me down." Don't want to sing that. Because the Bible said we shall humble ourselves. If we humble ourselves, then God don't have to humble us, right? And I mean, and I know the person meant well and wrote that. But if we humble ourselves, saints, then we don't have to pray, "If I'm too high, bring me down." First of all, you know if you're too high. You know, and if you're around some good brothers and sisters, they're going to tell you, "You're too high. You need to come down." We're going to start right there tonight. Praise God. I want to thank God for Bishop Jackson tonight giving me this opportunity. Thank God for you, the saints, Tabernacle Prayer Church family, and everybody else that will watch this video. We thank God for you, and we ask that you will see us again next week at 7:00. And we have service outside on Sunday mornings. Come and join us. Come and join us. All right? Let's pray. Father God, it's in Jesus' name we thank you. Thank you for opening our understanding. Thank you for this opportunity that you afforded us to be able to share over this technology. Bless everyone under the sound of my voice. Give them peace. Give them a peaceful rest tonight. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you. We'll see you next week.